Hello.
Hello.
Welcome to the Future of Brands London, the headline set. no pressure. Yes, my name's Katie Reddin-Clancy. I've just done a very exciting project with Rankin all about intersex. And here is our star, River Gallo, intersex actor and filmmaker. What is intersex? Good question. I certainly asked that when my best friend came out as transgender and introduced me to the spectrum of gender. Intersex people are born with variations in their biology and their genetics, so they are born in between the male and female binary. 1.7% of people are born intersex, the same amount of people who are born with red hair, but intersex people are fighting serious discrimination. So I'm very excited to be here talking about the power of creative ideas driving brand growth. With the iconic photographer, publisher, film director, cultural provocateur, /legend, Rankin.
Thank you. I'm not sure I live up to all of that.
Here's River again. So, we've just got just over 20, 25 minutes, and then I'm going to open up to some questions for you. So I'm just going to introduce the level of creativity that we're dealing with.
By the way, there's a lot of us, there's 80 of us, so it makes it feel like it's just me, but it's not.
Amazing. I'm just going to
dive in, let's get going.
So, what is the future for brands?
For me, how many people are brands here? Can I just get a show of hand? And how many people are agencies? Oh, not that many, okay. What are the rest of you then? Just interested parties. For me, as the world has become, especially the digital world, has become something that has, for me, it's almost like the Industrial Revolution, the invention of the printing press, and the invention of the engine, the motor car engine. It's like, if you imagine all those things like rolled into one, the world is literally turned upside down. The world is, we're looking at the world through a lens of yesterday that actually doesn't really work for today's world. So for me, what I find really fascinating, especially about the digital revolution, is as people are becoming more and more like brands every day, like they're becoming homogenous, they're becoming two-dimensional, they're becoming filtered, what brands have to do is they have to become more like people. And if brands can stop talking to the consumer and start talking to the audience they'll connect with the audience and they'll be able to make those connections impactful, and you'll be able to really relate to the people that are buying your products. If you're not doing that, if you're looking at the world through the lens of yesterday, which so many people are, so many people that actually are using social media don't know how to use social media. They don't know how it works. They don't know what it means. They don't know the difference between Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok. They literally don't. So if you're somebody that, if you're a marketing director and you're commissioning these people, if you're not using these things and you don't know how they work, how can you commission them properly? How do you know what effect they're having? How do you know what the data actually means on it? It's like, it's not 5 years ago. It's totally changed. And what the way I refer to it is, the world is turned upside down. So you have to turn upside down as well. And if you don't turn upside down, you're not going to be able to connect with audiences. And it's really that simple. So the way to do that is to editorialize your content, to really start thinking about yourself as a media owner. You know, some brands have loads more followers on social than the magazines do. So use your platforms and use your social media as a way of connecting with your audience as a media owner, as somebody that's creating media. And if you do that, then you'll connect with the audience. That's why PR is doing so well at the moment, because PR really has the ability to connect with the audience. They know what works, and they're not just letting the concepts up here filter down, drip down to the consumers. B2B doesn't work anymore. B2C doesn't work anymore. It's business to your audience, and you've got to treat them like an audience.
Where have you seen the power of a creative idea driving growth in the most impressive way?
For me, the most impressive thing I've ever seen was when Dove did the Real Beauty campaign. I was integral to that campaign. I was in a room with a guy called Dennis Lewis, and we came up with that campaign concept. And the audience loved that campaign so much that the sales of that product went up by 800%. So that's the most effective and the best way I've ever seen it used. And now that purpose is something that people are using everywhere. But if you're using purpose without a rationale behind it, I don't actually want to change anything, if you actually just want to use it to sell shit, people see through you, because the audience are so bored of people lying to them, because people have been lying to them for the last 3 years, especially in Britain and America, that they're like, tell us the fucking truth for a change. If you guys tell them the truth, they'll start to buy stuff because they'll trust you.
Diversity and inclusion, how do you bring them to brands?
Well, I just think that, like this, I know you've all been talking about diversity, but like, I've been talking about diversity for 30 years. I've been doing it for 30 years. I won't even talk to a brand if they're not inclusive. I won't even have that conversation. It's like, why wouldn't you want to do it? It's like, everybody buys shit. Why are you segmenting it into it? And I don't believe in demographic anymore. I believe in psychographic. And I know that's a Facebook term, but it actually works. And it's like, actually treat people like human beings and they'll buy your stuff like human beings. And it's really that simple. So demographic and diversity, it's like, what are we talking about? Why is that not just part of the base? That should be the baseline. Everything should be diverse. And if it isn't diverse, then you've got a real serious problem. And you should probably have a little chat with yourself, really.
Here's some of your work here. Let's see, a cover.
So that was the first plus-size model in a magazine, which was 94. That's Winnie Harlow. So we put her on the cover of our magazine. That, I mean, I've been shooting people of different age ranges for years. I think it's just normal. It shouldn't be something that's strange. This is a kid who's a model agency called Zebedee. He's got Down syndrome. When I suggested him to the magazine team, they said, why do we want to put him in the issue? What's the reason? I said, because he's a model. We should get him to model something. He's a model. That's what he does. Why don't we get him to do it? And people are going, but there has to be a reason. It's like, there doesn't have to be a reason. You just use people because they're out there doing stuff. And he's as diverse as they probably come. But he's also the most amazing kid. And you should be booking people on attitude and personality, not on what they look like. And this is something for changing faces that I did a couple of years ago. And again, you know, this is Amanda. You know, to me, this is normal. It's like, this is not something that's extraordinary. It should just be, this is a great thing to do. So when people come to me for these types of projects, I'm like, yeah, this is brilliant. We should all be doing stuff like this.
Can you give us a glimpse of how the creative process works with you guys?
In our office, what we try and do is have like a level playing field. So that means that, I mean, it sounds naff, but it means that when a brand comes to us, what we don't want to do is try and be excluding in any way. We try and bring them in. We want to make them part of the team. And I know that most people say that, but we actually do it. We want to listen to you. We don't want to get a brief from people. We want to create a brief with people, because creating the brief together means that you can actually affect change and you can do stuff that actually might fly below the radar, but also might get you incredible press. And I think that when you work together, and that goes from the kids making the coffee and the teas to the juniors on the creative team, if they don't challenge me and they don't challenge the team, then we're not doing good work.
And here we've got the Rolls-Royce job that you did. Shall I play it?
Yeah, I think just this is an interesting one, because we were asked by Rolls-Royce to look at the Phantom car, which is their highest end vehicle and most expensive car. And one of the things they wanted us to do is challenge them as a brand, but at the same time, they didn't want to put off their existing customers. So what we did was create this, and I can talk about it afterwards.
This is the end. The end of all the boring rules. I don't do well with rules. I never have. First off, make sure the Phantom is clean and presentable.
Maintain the correct image expected of a Rolls. The loudest noise you should hear is the ticking of the clock.
Utmost care must be taken of the finest leather interiors.
Careful, darling.
Phantom. Rules rewritten.
So just quickly, I believe that most great ideas come from insights and strategy. So this idea came from a set of rules that Rolls-Royce have about how to drive their cars. And we took that idea and we rewrote those rules and said, this isn't how people actually interact with cars. So let's make it more realistic. Let's put a woman in it and let's make that woman the most powerful woman that you could ever be. Gwendolyn Christie, she can take a Rolls-Royce and throw it around a few corners, and she did. And the thing is that it might not feel like a massive stretch for you guys, but for Rolls-Royce, this was a really massive stretch, like a really massive stretch. But the audience absolutely loved it. Their Instagram went bananas. The interaction that they had was fantastic. And the KPIs were spot on it. So we, you know, there was a few things that got taken out of them, out of the cut. One was when Gwendolyn takes a hot dog and throws it over her shoulders and it lands on the seat. They didn't let that in, which is fair enough. You know, it's like we want to respect the car, but at the same time, they let us shoot it. They let us shoot it. And I think that's the thing. It's like, because we work so closely with the team, and we had so much trust from the CEO and the CMO, we were allowed to do that and try and push them and see how far we could take it. And that's the thing. I don't want to do an agency or a creative service that wins awards. I want to do a creative service that sells stuff, for the brands, that works for the brands. And I don't want to be this elitist creative sitting in front of you going, I know, you know, much more about creativity than you. I know what I know, and I know how to execute something really well, and I probably know a good idea, but I want to open it up and be very, very, very much a round table. And that includes PR and digital. We don't want to silo anything, and that's what's really important. If you unsilo your approach, you start to be able to talk, and all your touch points start to work. And it's really that simple. It's really not a complicated concept, but everybody seems to find it hard to understand.
You talk about telling the truth, and then you did a cool front cover here. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Well, I just think people are scared. We're all scared of Facebook. Most brands are scared of Facebook because it's so integral to their sales, you know, now. It's so integral. But actually, they just stepped over the line, you know, and Carol called them out on it. And instead of using the drum to promote myself, I thought, let's promote something that is actually really interesting, which is the truth. It's because the truth, and if you use the truth and honesty within what you're doing at a brand level, you will have effect, and it will be long-term effect, and it will be something that, you know, you can put, you can put in your portfolio going forward, because your sales will go up. They just will, because that's what people want. And this isn't, you know, I sound a bit like I'm preaching, but it's like, the reality is, this isn't a trend. You know, this thing of truth and honesty is not a trend. We're sick of it. We're sick of what being sold by politicians. We're sick of what we're being sold by social media companies. And you need to flip it. And I'm just not going to sit there and say I'm scared of Facebook, because I don't think any of us should be scared of it.
Is there a job that's really shaped your career and shaped brand Rankin?
I don't think so. But I mean, the one thing that's interesting is when I photographed the Queen, because I'm from Scotland, so we have a natural distrust for royalty. So I was a little bit unsure about whether I should do it, but I did it. And that shoot in its entirety, like, you know, I'd been shooting for, I think, 14 years up to that, shooting and then coming out. After that, if anybody ever questioned whether I could take their picture, I just said, well, I've photographed the Queen. So, you know, Madonna, the Queen.
Yeah. Creative ideas aren't just about visual work, are they? I mean, there's creative processes, strategy, thinking. Do you still think there's a place for creative agencies?
Yeah, but I think the agencies have to flip. You know, the model's fucked. It doesn't work. It's the construct, the way that we all interact with each other, it doesn't work. You can't have these egos and these massive teams, you know, of account people making this work. It doesn't work. And also, sorry, but when you used to make three things a year or four things a year, it was fine. Now you have to make four things a week. Maybe four things a day. And if you want to make four things a day, you've got to change the way you work. And unfortunately, these dinosaurs, and if there's any in the room, I'm sorry, you're not moving fast enough. You're moving too slow. And the ship has sailed, guys. You've got to go and find out how to make it work. And the way we're doing is it works. And there are other people out there that are doing it the way we're doing it, but you have to change. So it's not that creative services are done, they've morphed. They've morphed and they've shapeshift. And unfortunately, that means that social brands, because if you don't, then you're gonna get caught. And there are brands that are doing it, like, you look at Unilever. Unilever are really integral to changing things. And there are people like Rolls Royce that are catching up with it. So, and they've got great, you know, they've got some great ideas. So it's not dead, it's got to move forward, it's got to change. The model's change is dead.
You inspire collaboration with the wider industry as well in your call-outs to creatives, particularly in the marketing world with your creative influence book here. How does that affect the
Well, the thing is, I'm a director and a photographer, so I don't want to just stop working, you know. Like, I don't want to not work with other people, because I love shooting, and it's like getting me into do a bake on something is really good, because I'm doing it, I understand insights and strategy. But the wider context is that we can't do this alone. Nobody can do it alone anymore. So if you're not bringing your PRs into it and your digital teams into it and your creative team and bringing them all together and going, okay, let's find a solution here. No, not one of them's leading and let the others trail behind in their wake, you know, which is what a lot of the big creative agencies have been doing for a long time. But actually going, okay, let's make these things work together. Then you have more effect. It just is the ability to actually come together and make these things solid really works. And that's what we do all the time. You know, we do it day in, day out.
Yeah. There's some faces you might recognise.
So these are all marketing directors I photographed for a book I did called Creative Influence.
And you also talk about telling the truth.
Yeah.
And when was the last time you told the truth?
About 5 minutes ago. I did an amazing Standard Life campaign on endometriosis at the beginning of the year, which really was absolutely exceptional as far as I was concerned, not because of my work, but because of the people's stories. And, you know, I think to me, those types of campaigns, which are not traditional, it was an experiential campaign with a kind of ambassador sort of edge to it, and it was linked to charity. What was brilliant about that was the cut through was massive. It was, I think we had something like 60 articles on it, you know, in the press. And that's what I mean about the press. It's like, you know, that's why PR companies are doing really well, because if you can get something in the media does still work. It's just how you approach the media, and it has to be earned. If it's not earned, you know, it doesn't generally, you can't just buy it anymore because people aren't interested. So that campaign specifically was telling great stories that I didn't know. I didn't know what endometriosis was. I couldn't even say it for the first 3 days that I was on the campaign. But I know I would say that probably quite a few people in this room don't know what it is, but it affects something like
one in 10
people. So that's one of my subjects. so that was one of the last times I've told the truth in a campaign, and it really is effective.
And we also saw this on your gram.
Yeah, you need to challenge this stuff. It's like these influencers that have been running your lives for the last, you know, 2 years, it's like they're having a laugh. You know, most of them are lying to you, and there's no code of ethics at all in anything to do with it. And we're not even trying to put a code of ethics into it. We're all just running scared. And it's like, I don't buy followers. I think it's disgusting to buy followers. I think also having enough money to be able to go on holiday, fucking pay for it. Why do you get it for free and everybody else doesn't? I could get it for free, but I think that's outrageous to do that. So, you know, I think integrity is something that we've lost. You know, we've lost the egos, or some of the egos, and the kind of old way of working, but we've also lost a lot of the integrity that goes with it. And what I'm trying to say is put some integrity back into the game.
Yeah. How does the casting affect a campaign, the personality of the model or the celebrity? Or
I mean, it's to me, I mean, I've shot influencers, and they're all, you know, they seem to be quite nice people. You know, on the face of it. But the reality is that, you know, it shouldn't be about that. You know, for me, it's about personality, attitude, looks, and then how many followers you've got, really. That should be what it is. But of course, every brand wants to know about it now. And how do we even know what they're doing? How many bots they've got? How many villages in a third world country that they've got to follow them. You know, we don't know. We just have no... And Facebook aren't giving it to you guys. They're not telling you this stuff. They're not outing them because it takes their share price down. So, you know, what I'm saying is put some integrity back into it, and hopefully we can change the industry a little bit, because that's what I'm here to do. And that's why we have the expression, we want to change the world. Yeah, it might only be the world of marketing, but hopefully that'll have an influence outside of what we're doing.
Anyone can be a creator now, can't they? Even if you have a glamergency.
This is just
fun.
Hi, it's
me again. I'm in North London in my studio. I'm doing a beauty shoot. Oh, hold on. It's the glamour phone. Glamergency, what service do you require? Lipstick smudge? I'll be right there.
That's me on TikTok, right? So I'm a 53-year-old on TikTok. It feels weird. And my wife keeps asking me why I keep taking selfies. And I'm like, I'm not taking selfies, I'm exploring the medium. But what I'm saying is I'm actually exploring the medium. You know, I'm not just talking about it.
What do you think is
next? Are we not done? Do you not want to ask? See that red light that's flashing? Doesn't that mean something?
Yes. We're on our last question, so okay. That's probably good.
I just wanted to see if anyone wanted to ask me a question.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, does anyone have
Yeah, let's
questions?
Just cut to you guys. I'm boring. Yes.
Yes?
Yes. Uh-oh.
Sorry.
You've got microphones.
We've all got microphones in our chairs. It's crazy.
Oh, have you? This is so high-tech, this place, isn't it?
Obviously, a lot of your work is very brave, and there was a time a number of years ago where a CEO would say, I want my campaign to go viral, and now I think a lot of CEOs are terrified for it to kind of go to that stage. But it is, you know, how do you comfort a CEO from saying, you know, this campaign's brave, but we might get a backlash that could go against the press or whatever?
I mean, I keep coming back to this. What is everyone scared about a backlash for? What are you scared of? Really, what are you scared of? That people might not buy your product? Really? Because honestly, they might not buy it for a couple of weeks, you know? It's not a big deal. A backlash, let's create, controversy is good. You know, it used to be that any press was good press. And suddenly it's like, oh no. You know, I think that people make absolute, you know, stupid mistakes. Look at Pepsi. I mean, that's the stupidest campaign you've ever seen in your life. But then that's them cutting corners. Paying someone money that they shouldn't be paying them because they're asking for far too much because there's no ethics in that. They've, whoever that was, it's probably not got the number of followers they've really got. And then they've not got anybody of any sense in the room, and definitely no one of any colour in the room. That's for fucking sure, isn't it? So, you know, that's just stupid. Literally, like, if you're stupid and get press, that's your fault. But don't be stupid. It's really simple. Have someone in the room that goes, there's an elephant there, that no one really believes anything you're saying. You know, about this product or about this person. There's a great Saturday Night Live sketch about it where the directors, it comes from the director's perspective if anyone's not seen it. But I think that and, you know, the H&M one was, I mean, there's been some dumb ones, but I think what's this back, that 5,000 people that might write something negative, life goes on, you know? Most female MPs are getting more than that, you know, in a week at the moment. I don't know how much you read the press, but, you know, it's like, be brave. Be a human being.
Any more questions? Yes?
Oh, yeah, so I pressed the button. So you said that your purpose was to change the world. So yeah. When you first started in your career, was this always your purpose? Has this evolved over time?
I didn't think I could change the world when I first started. And, you know, I got into photography because I couldn't draw. And I loved being in a creative environment, but I didn't know what else to do. And then when I picked up a camera, it was like, oh yeah, I know what to do. And then literally from starting to take pictures, I realized that I could have a conversation with the audience. So right from the beginning, I've always had these things that I've made that I've been trying to like create a conversation or maybe just push boundaries that's just been very natural for me. It's not something that I've come to. It's just grown within me. But then, and it's going to sound a little bit pious, but like I went to the Congo with Oxfam, and I could not believe the extent of, you know, everything, the poverty, the how were people living, and the positivity of those people that I met was so immense that I was like, I have to go back and have that conversation for them. People go, you're a fashion photographer, but I'm like, I'm a portrait photographer that lives in a bubble in Kentish Town, you know, and I had to go back and say, and I suddenly realised that actually I could have that, I could stand up for people and speak for them. And I think that was the point where I was like, actually, you can do great work on here and still earn money. It's not, you can balance it if you're prepared to do it. And also, I guess I'm saying is I'm challenging people to, why can't we all do it? It shouldn't even be a question in my head. It should just be, this is what we should all be doing. Maybe it sounds a bit narrow, but
I
see
questions?
It like that.
Any more hands up? Yes?
Yes. Oh. Sorry.
That's fine. Hello. Hi.
Hi. Works.
Hi. Just a very quick one. Could you give us a flavour of how you would shift opinion an engagement. I work for a bank, it's not sexy. But in a category like this, we're actually, you know, bankers or, you know, in a short way, wankers, essentially.
Yeah. it's really editorializing what you're doing. So, you know, one of the things that I always argue with my team about, like, I'll give you an example, right? So I was approached by a leading high street fashion brand to create a content concept or a campaign concept, they call it, to get them PR. And I said, well, you've got 300 stores in the UK, and your insights and strategy are saying, stop using celebrities to sell us shit we don't want, right? So I said, why don't you, don't worry about, you know, getting the PR on a kind of national level. Let's take one person from each store and make them the person we put in the ads for that area and that store, right? And I said, if you do that, and we do a little bit of media training on every person to be the celebrity of that store, you're gonna get 330 local newspapers putting that person on the front cover. You're gonna get 330 local TV stations putting them in some sort of story. You're gonna get all the radio stations. And then what's gonna happen is Holly Willoughby's gonna have to talk about it because it's a national campaign that no one else has ever done before. And that, unfortunately, that high street brand decided to do celebrities like talking about themselves as influencers. And I'm like, that's cool, guys, but that campaign concept is amazing. Now my team are going, that's not an idea. And I'm going, I don't know where your idea's come from, but that's a really fucking good idea, right? Because, yeah, I could maybe... I know you think it's executional, but it isn't. It's editorial. I'm going, let's make these people the star of what we're talking about. Now, of course, yeah, Dove have done it, and everyone go, oh, Dove have done that. But they've stopped doing it. I don't know if anyone's noticed, but they've stopped doing it. It's up for grabs again, and it's easy. And also, just because Dove do it doesn't mean other people can't do it. You can do it and do it differently, and you can bring something different to it. And my thing was, you know, I want to see real people in your clothes. That's what I want to see, and that's what I want to photograph. So to me, you know, I don't know about banks. You'd have to brief me, and we'd have to sit down and chat about it. But honestly, that's the approach. It's like there's ways of doing these things which are appealing to the public, because everybody wants their 5 minutes now, and they want everybody else to have their 5 minutes. And I don't mean influencers. I mean, most people have a voice now. I'm not everyone's got a voice, because that would be ridiculous to say, but most people have a voice and they want to use it. And I think that that's more interesting. I mean, people go micro-influencer. I'm like, what, you mean real people? You know, okay, cool. So, you know, that's an example.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Don't nick it, though. Sorry.
Hi. Can you hear me? Yeah. Thank you. This is all really interesting. Back to Dove. So obviously at the time that was an amazing move in terms of real beauty, and I know you're saying that maybe there's not so much of that at the moment. Earlier in campaign this week, it was reported that eating disorders are on the rise. So although we have all of this body positivity, it's not filtering through into how people are feeling.
No. Well, it's worse than that. Yeah.
It's worse.
It's worse than that. Yeah. It's not filtering through. It's filtering through. It's not having effect.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And similarly with kind of diversity in advertising, I think it's improving, but also racial hatred is on the rise, as is
Absolutely.
Attacks with disabilities. What would be, because there's a lot of brands in the room, do you have any advice going beyond just improving the diversity of creative, like what they can be doing to make actually a real impact?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I mean, weirdly, when we were prepping for this, we talked about this a lot, and my my thoughts on it are quite extreme, but you know, the one thing that the self-harming and body dysmorphia and things like that, we've created this. Kind of our industry is a bit of a bubble as well, because we have improved dramatically, and I talk about that a lot. in terms of, you know, as an industry, people are going, but surely you're part of it. I'm like, no, well, if you actually look at the industry, they're doing a lot of really good stuff. But unfortunately, on a mobile phone, which is completely addictive and designed to be addictive, the social media platform that the kids are using is addictive and is designed to be addictive. And then the app that they're using to change their bodies, right? Because you can get an app now that's like a Photoshop, a very, very basic version of Photoshop. That's addictive as well. It's kind of gamified, which is even worse. So it's really, really difficult to talk about it in terms of, unless we start having these debates and discussions, like if I was talking to, you know, a beauty brand now, I'd be saying, let's do something against this and let's talk about that. Because the thing that I find really interesting is in sort of 99 to 2003, 2004, if you Photoshopped someone the wrong way, it was front page news in the media, right? Now, no one's talking about these 10, 11, 12-year-old kids. They're changing their faces, and then they're asking their parents, and I'm sure some of you are experiencing this, to have plastic surgery or Botox by the time they're 14, 15, 16. Now, to me, that's what we should be discussing on a daily level. So that's the kind of thing I would be trying to, you know, for me, it's not enough. That's, I guess, what I'm saying. To just go, okay, diversity should not even be a question. It shouldn't even be brought up by anybody ever. And in all of this other stuff, we need to tackle what the problem is. And the problem, and it really truly is this constantly needing to be on all the time. All the time connected. It's really unhealthy on every single level for everybody. So I'd be getting brands to say, you know, one of my slogans that I came up with last year was fuck FOMO, you know, which is fear of missing out, get into JOMO, which is the joy of missing out, and encouraging people to be bored, encouraging people not to use your products, you know, encouraging people to actually have a life, you know, IRL, you know, stuff like that. I think that would be effective and actually might push for change because, yeah, absolutely, it's a real problem.
Do we have one final question?
I've done it. I've probably said fuck too much, haven't I? He's given me a dirty look.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much for joining us here.
Thank you.
Thank you to Rankin. That's a wrap.